Peace and Black Power family, you already know what it is. This is your Sa.Netr, and I'm coming at you with my brother Gano Grills, and he's going to be dealing with Kundalini Reiki. All right, October the 10th, you want to be in the building? This is a powerful workshop for my brother. Also, we also have coming up an altar workshop coming up as well, October the 18th. You want to make sure you be in the building, all right? Go and look the brother up. I'm sorry, I got a bad cold right now, so it's not working good for me. But we got it going on right now. Brother Gano Grills. Peace, family. My brother, Gano Grills. Gano Grills is taking his knowledge and information to the people, to the streets, where the people are at. Make no mistake about it. This brother is official. Peace and Black Power, family.
My brother Gano Grills in the building. Actor, producer, teacher, spiritual advisor.
Yes, sir.
All the above. What's happening, my brother? How you been?
Doing well, man. How are you, King? Glad to be here.
Good.
Yes, sir.
Introduce yourself to the people, for those of them who may not know you, because we got new fans that's watching YouTube. You know, we know you're a legend, but introduce yourself anyway for the people that may not know who you are.
Okay. My name is Gano Grills. I am a spiritual advisor, actor, graffiti engineer, father, host of other things. If I had to put it in a nutshell, that's what it would be.
Okay, my brother, talk to the people. I know you got something powerful coming up, and I want you to really deal with that first before I bring Red Pearl in, Brother Longwind. We call him Brother Longwind. But I want you to really deal with that, and why is this important that you got coming up, my brother?
Okay. October the 10th, which is coming up, I have a Kundalini Reiki initiation that will be happening on 116th Street, and it's going to empower anybody who comes to be a Kundalini Reiki master, all three levels, the certificate. Now, a lot of people don't really know what the Kundalini is. The Kundalini is the divine energy that sits at the base of your spine. It is your divine birthright given to you by your creator. And most people will die without even knowing how to use their Kundalini, which is ludicrous. So, one of my assignments here on Earth is to activate people's Kundalini so that they can use it in this lifetime to do what it is that they came here to do. Because there's nobody here walking around on the planet that did not come here with a specific assignment, or maybe a myriad of assignments. But the Kundalini being activated and working functionally will allow you to do what it is that you came here to do, as well as a host of other things like heal people from a distance, heal yourself from past life issues. Me and the brother were talking about, he was asking me about reincarnation and why is it that karma, how can you prove that karma, past life karma is real? And those are very legitimate questions. I like that. So I speak to those questions and those misnomers, and these things are sciences that our people need to be made more aware of. Why is that? It is because we're walking around and the elements are controlling us. Why are the elements controlling you? Why do you not have the ability to control the elements? Forget about the elements. Why do you not have the ability to control the own forces that are working in your life that are opposing you? Like the planets keeping you in a financial disability, or you not having a relationship or a mate that you could attract. So these are some of the things that this workshop, it's not a workshop, it's an initiation, and I'll be having this very soon. And on the other side, October the 18th, it's the altar workshop, which is a very powerful, it's a powerful workshop that will show and prove how to utilize these forces to your advantage.
So how can you prove karma exists?
Say that again?
How can you prove karma exists?
Okay. You prove that karma exists, and I don't know if that actually, what I could say is that karma is a real force in the universe that gives you the receipt of your actions here on earth. Many people are walking around in the conditionality of what their karma has produced. There are people that are born, like I told you before, three-year-old children that remember their last lifetime as someone's grandmother. They live in a country and they have no access to rehearse a script, but they have full knowledge of where the bank key is, who their ancestors are. How would a three-year-old know that if the karmic faculty was not real? Also, reincarnation. Now, reincarnation is a real thing, but karma is an event of reincarnation. And the reason that karma is a real thing, because you reap what you sow. So do unto others as others will do unto you. These are some of the axioms that we all know about, but karma is a real thing. So if you punch somebody in the face, there's going to be an immediate karmic backlash for that. That's the remedial version of karma. So whether the person reacts to you or not, maybe the person may say, oh, you know, you got that. I'm going to go back and get a gat and come and toast you up. That's what karma is. When we don't look at what karma brings to us, then we're subjugated to what the forces are that are going to teach us what karma is. A guy goes and he has sex with 25 women and he doesn't have any commitment with them. His karma might be 5 children that he's related to and has to pay child support for the next 18 years. And he's disassociated with that responsibility. But the karmic act of him doing that will teach him the ways of his inequity. So that's just a couple of examples that I could give you about karma and how it works.
So you said karma is the receipt of the quality of the existence of your life, right?
Or karma is the receipt of your actions, of what you've been doing here on earth. Not only here in this lifetime, but other lifetimes. Yes.
So can you inherit karma?
Yes.
You can inherit karma.
You can inherit karma.
So where's white people's karma?
White people's karma, in terms of what it is that they have, it might not have fully come around yet. Everybody is an individual. Everybody has an individual karmic score. So you can't broad stroke a whole populace of people and say, where are... Right. Let me finish my point. So my point is, there are certain people that are dealing with horrible karmic things. And like I said, everybody has an individual karmic score, like everybody has an individual credit score or not. So you can't really gauge it by the totality of a group of people and say where white people's karma. You can't gauge it like that. You have to look at everybody on a case-by-case basis.
Now, I believe in karma. Don't get me wrong. I just want to know, like, how can you prove karma's existence? Like, I understand that for every action, there's an opposite and equal reaction. I understand that every action has a consequence.
Right.
But you're saying that karma can transcend into the next lifetime.
Yes.
So if karma can transcend into the next lifetime, that means that in a past lifetime, I've done something to deserve the knowledge I've inherited now, right?
Could be, yes.
So I'm saying, if karma is inherited, how can you prove its inheritance?
How can you prove its inheritance? Well, if you look at your condition, there's something called the natal chart. The natal chart is something that you could look at just to see how your planets are aligned, what blessings you have in certain houses. That's one way that you could prove it. You could also look at where your challenges are in life. Some people have a financial challenge. That is the karmic backlash that may come from not just the planetary alignment, but it's something that may come from your ancestors, because your ancestors owed people lots of money. So if you have an inability to pay your bills and to gain finances and to do well with the facility of money, more likely than not, you have a karmic repercussion that is opposing you. However, there are also things that we can do to mitigate and dissolve those opposing forces. A lot of our people suffer with something that I call spirit of lack. Spirit of lack is a conditionality that doesn't allow us to entertain the ability to be able to jump on a plane and go on holiday or go on a vacation at will, because we don't have the wherewithal to do so. That is a conditioning that we readily accept because we spend the most money, but we don't work together cohesively to keep money within our own spheres. But my point really is, like I said before, karma is an area of study that, how old are you?
I'm 16.
That's beautiful. So you're still young. And if you start studying certain literature and you start working with the forces of your own karma, and you start studying the overt as well as subtleties of how karma works, you will be way ahead of the game. That's one of the reasons why I put the altar workshop together, to show people, show and prove how it works. And I have the video footage, I have the pictures, I have all of those things. I didn't want to go too much into that today, but like I said, coming to the altar workshop will show you that. Also, it gives you the antidote to what some of those trepidations and obstacles may be in anybody's lives. And if we don't look at that, then we're type foolish.
Peace, brother. Peace, brother Gano. I want to talk about altars real quick. I'm glad that you brought that up. I was doing some research. We're going to do something on the Pope on a blood moon on Monday, entitled When in Rome, Brother Blue Pill and I. And I did some research, and it showed that the first stop that the Pope made was in Cuba, right, to visit the altar of a Santeria deity or Santeria saint. Then prior to that, I was doing research, and I came across the phenomenon that's taking place in Mexico right now with the worship and the death culture of La Moreta and the altars that they've set up all around Mexico in reverence to her and what it is that she's doing. I don't want to get too much deep in that, but it's dealing with these drug cults, these narco cults, the cartels that we know about. It explained how these are actually, you know, death cults.
Right.
You dig what I'm saying? And they're actually doing death rituals, and they're actually tapping into the underworld, and they're tapping into the underworld.
So what's and the question?
The question is, they're using these altars to summon this entity and these spirits, right? I want to know from you, if you're dealing with the dark arts as well as dealing with, you know, the light arts and whatnot, what is the power that altars can afford us as a people right now, wanting to get in touch with spiritual powers?
That's a great question. And you highlight it here, right, as we speak. And he's been traveling in a pentagram. And he's traveling along these ley lines to accumulate the energies of certain people's prayers. When people pray to the iconography of the cross, which is an event, in my opinion, that I'll withhold for myself, but there's a school of thought regarding the cross that people pray to every single day. They give their, I'll wait. Thank you, brother. They give their energy and they give the power of their own divinity over to an event that never happened. And because those thought forms and those formations of thoughts are real things, every time you have a thought about something, whether it's egregious or it's homeostatic, it has to go somewhere. Where does it go? It goes to the ley lines. And for an occultist that knows where those ley lines are, which are lines of power, lines of force, I'll tell you something else, and I'll get back to that. There was a broom that ended up somehow on a line of force. You can look this up. The broom cannot be moved. The broom, people tried to push it, and the broom would not move because it ended up on a line of force. What makes the line of force so powerful? A lot of the prayers, which is a lot of the dark gods that rule and the darker forms of ritual that people use with some of these altars, which is not what I deal with, these gods are ensouling that power that comes from that altar. I'm going to answer the question about how we could use the altar to our advantage in a second. So the Pope travels along these ley lines and he collects through ritual and maybe some sacrifice. That's not something that we would hear about. And he collects and harvests those energies, brings it back to the Vatican, and continues to be the leading authoritarian on religion and God. But the problem is that when people pray to God and the iconography of the cross and who sits on the cross, it doesn't represent the creator of all. Therefore, when you pray in God's name, and Jesus' name, unfortunately, you're not praying to the creator of all. So those prayers are usurped and taken by another entity and used however they feel to use the energy. And this is the reason why a lot of our people are suffering, because we give our divine energy to an archetype that had nothing to do with love and light. And that's another reason why I'm reprogramming the consciousness of anybody that comes before me how to deal with the altar. But first, you have to connect to Mother Earth. You have to connect to your ancestors. You have to connect to your divine parents who were gods. And then you connect to the creator of all. We don't even know about the gods. The gods are real. And I'm not talking about the 5% nation. I'm talking about the gods who were alive and well in the formation of a human in an ethereal body before the beginning began. We're very foolish to think that there were beings here that were not alive before the planet, that we're the center of the universe, that we were the first ones created, and the gods of the Bible will have you believe that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and then he created you. That's a thought form that is drastically flawed, and it's also the empirical reason why we are struggling. If you look at these imageries on the wall, a lot of these people, unfortunately, gave their power over. Look at this. Look at this. These are things that really happened. A lot of us ended up in that situation because we were giving our energy and our prayers and our worship to the wrong one. So I don't want to castigate or alienate anyone who has a belief in the church. The church is important, but it is also cursory and remedial. You have second grade education, and then you have collegiate education. And the vastivity between the two is a labyrinth and a chasm.
Indeed. Powerful. And speaking on the whole Pope visit, his last place that he will be visiting is Virginia.
Yes.
Okay. You know, and then he canonized a conquistador in L.A., you know.
Right.
And he's a Jesuit, the Black Pope, but we'll get into that.
Right.
Can you briefly speak about getting in touch, like you said, getting in touch with the elements? Because the elements would be the unseen, the forces that all spiritual traditional systems tap into. They have different names,
right.
Palo Mayombe, Santeria, you know, all of Ifa, all of these things. But what we know is they're tapping into the same unseen four elements. There's no other way to, you know, they give it African names. They have Spanish names. They have European saint names. But it's the same thing. So what I want to know from you is, two questions. If that's the case, does one have to identify with the specific system if just knowing that it's the manipulation of the unseen forces of the four elements? And what it, and if not, what would be the significance of being a part of one of these systems? You know what I mean? The pros and the cons.
Well, when people are on a team, they identify with the symbol of the team, and they play on that team. They're not bouncing around from, you know, this team to that team. It's important that you clarify what team you're on. And a lot of people, and let's use the Akan, let's use Yame Osaringa, let's use Ifa, Lukumi, Santeria. In Cuba, one of the reasons, in my opinion, that the Pope went to Cuba is that when we were being brought over here in masses, when we had the when we had Ifa, when we had Ashe, when we were practicing our ritual, the way that it was kept alive, Cuba kept it alive. And they had to turn it into something different. And they called it Lukumi, Santeria. It is also true that they are predominantly Catholics. So the inequity is the rituals that you use are going to validate and give you a sense of power, because the rituals connect you to not only your ancestors, but let's just use Ifa as an example. Every devotee, every Yawo, every priest, every Babalero, they have a connection and they know who their divine parents are. Kemetic priests know who their divine parents are. One of my fathers is Tahuti. And that's the reason why I have a lot of success. Absolutely. So that makes us brothers, right? That's the reason why I have a lot of command over the Ankh. I don't even have to try to do anything. But when I hold an ankh and if I point it at somebody, somebody might be blasted out of their bodies. That's because the energy that makes up the energy of my soul is created by a god named Tahuti or Lord Thoth or Trismegistus, whatever you'd like to call him. Just by you knowing who your divine parent is, it's a major source of power. But I want to get back to the question. Okay. How is it that working with the altar and what does that do for you? It gives you not only a sense of purpose, but it gives you a team to play on. Okay. There are some people that are playing for the dark side, mm-hmm. and they also get the power that comes with that. Right. The Illuminati, the Gay Boule, all of those things. Now, I'm not saying that there's a benefit that has a dead end to it. So, yeah, you'll raise to fame and fortune. If you look at some of how Whitney Houston was sacrificed, there's a really good YouTube video that talks about how Whitney Houston died. Look at that. Look at how her daughter, 24 hours before Whitney died, her daughter almost drowned in that same tub. How was that possible if that was not a ritual? A dark ritual, though. Dark rituals come with a lot of power real fast, but it also has a payback. So if you look at somebody like Paula Deen or Bill Cosby, how in the world did Bill Cosby get away with allegedly doing what he did for over 30 years without a scratch? All of a sudden, there's a recompense and a karmic backlash, right? So Bill Cosby now has to answer, and the way that it came out was by some Hannibal Buress, who was really like, hadn't even honed his skills yet. But the planetary alignment that exposed what Bill Cosby allegedly did was his undoing. Also, the dynasty, the legacy that Bill Cosby built is forever tarnished. If Bill Cosby was working with an altar, that never would have happened. Mm-hmm. Paula Deen, even though she's an Amorite, mm-hmm. she had a spiritual advisor to advise her on when not to say certain things and whatnot, she would not be where she is. And a lot of the potential of what she was able to gain is forever lost because she has a potty mouth. So I hope that answers the question, does it?
Yes.
Okay.
You have questions?
How do we find our divine parents?
That's a good question. How do you find out who your divine parents are? Most initiates who are initiated into some of that, you know what I mean? Cool. Yeah. So you had a question.
Yeah. How do we find our divine parents?
Okay. How can one find their divine parents? Myself as a high priest, unless you are initiated by me, I would not be able to tell you directly. But one of the ways that you can find out on your own is to sit quietly in meditation and ask the energy of your soul, which resides here, here, and here, and wait patiently for the answer. Your parents who are gods do not just give you that information unless they see that you are working to become the best possible version of who they intended you to be. If they don't see those markers in your character, which people call Iwapele, they're going to sit back and wait for you to come around for another lifetime. And when they see that you're working to become enlightened, that's when it comes to you.
So how do you know what they want you to become?
Everybody on the planet is here for the same reason. All of us have parents. Some of us have parents that are demons. Some of us have parents that are jinns. Those darker, and I don't mean complexion, because a lot of people get hung up on that. Those children are here for the light body. They're here to get ascension. They're here to reconfigure the chaos of their hard wiring. It's the only reason why they're here. Children that are star seeds and children of light, they are also here to establish a long school of education to make their way back to the Creator. What do your parents, I can tell you right now, what do your parents expect of you? They expect you to be all that you can be, like the army. They expect for you to go as high as you could possibly go, as deep as you could possibly go, to expand into the fullness of your dormancy. So all of us are walking around a dormant being predominantly. And we scratch the surface very little of what we're capable of doing. So your parents who put you here because you're a projection of their essence, I'll give you an example of that. If you look at a lot of the Rubenesque women, that have, you know, they're very, very ample. Those are children of the creator gods of fertility. That's why they have that body type. If you look at men like this brother here, myself, maybe Idris Elba, some of the, you know, other brothers, we might be children of Shango, children of the god Tahuti. There are certain mannerisms and body types and character points that we have. And if you look at yourself, you'll see that you are probably, you seem like more like a Shango to me. I feel Shango coming from you. You're probably a child of Shango. Shango is a, right, he's a god of thunder and lightning. And his day is on Thursday. And you seem more like, Haru or maybe even Ogun. Has anybody ever told you that before? Okay, yes.
All right. I can look at that as a possibility about the father or the mother not giving them information or giving them information according to what they see. Now, this brother here is my student, right? And I'm teaching the brother. But he's not my biological child, you know what I'm saying? But I came upon his spirit, came upon mine, and I decided that I had to teach him. What reference is that when it comes to that particular topic that you are speaking about now?
Okay. Well, one of the things I could tell you, and I hope this doesn't startle you, but there's no way that you and him would have had the attraction as he was probably your father in another lifetime. There's no way that two people come together and have an affinity for one another unless they have spent time in another lifetime. When you have an attraction to someone or an affinity or an unspoken connection with someone, 99% of the time it is because you've lived another lifetime with that person, maybe as their father, as their mother, brother, sister, uncle, or niece, and you've come back into this lifetime, right? Think about it. You regale him as a student and you're teaching him all the things that you know. You're finishing what you did and do in another lifetime. So if you were to compare your astrological charts, you would probably see that, wow, okay, these stars are aligned here in this house. We have a kinship. And that's what proves that affinity.
So the answer to your question, young God, the answer to your question that you asked him is in front of you. You're living out the answer to your question in his mentorship. You feel what I'm saying? So your journey is taking place in real time. And your teacher, who will be your master teacher, is in front of you now. And he's bringing out the greatness that is inside of you that lays dormant as a young, like a seed. A seed that grows into an oak tree. Hold on.
Would you describe him? Because based on what he said, my parents are here to bring something out in me, right? Or I'm here to fulfill whatever my parents have brought me here for. My ancestors, they, in order for me to have access to them, I have to be following the path, or I have to be following the vision that they had for me, right? So now, my biological parents might not necessarily have had the same vision that he had for me. So I'm asking you, would you describe him as my father if he's awakening, quote-unquote, dormant powers in me?
I would describe him, and I would say that your physical family and your biological family is only the team that sponsored you to come into embodiment. So it has very little value. When people place their totality of the value on their physical family, a lot of times they're not close. They have an estrangement and they have an alienation with their own. I have a son that's 19 years old, and me and him butt heads a lot. I have five children, but he's one of them that I realize that he's my physical son, but the reality of the situation is he's here on another agenda. So there are people that may be more your divine cosmic family or your spirit family than even your the physicality of who you came in under in this lifetime. Usually those people that the kinship that you have is stronger than what you have with the biology of the family name that you share. And that happens a lot.
I would ask Seville, what school of knowledge did you come up in, brother?
Who's your first enlightener?
Oh, I was a 5%er.
So Father Allah was your father?
Of course he was.
Spiritual
Yes.
Okay, so with that concept, it's the same concept that I'm saying, and we out here, and that rack of DVDs has a lot of my fathers there. Dr. Sabi is my father. Phil Valentine is my father. Dr. Ben is my father. You feel what I'm saying? These are my spiritual fathers. I've accepted their teachings. Elijah Muhammad, Malcolm X, you know, fatherhood. You know what I'm saying? Fatherhood. Help me find a better check side of myself. Check those people. Yeah, you understand?
No. Get what I'm saying.
Yeah,
catch that. I want you to catch that.
You know?
How y'all doing? Sa.Netr T.V., House of Consciousness. Check it out.
So, you know, as it's one thing to be here as gods and, you know, but if we're not raising up the gods amongst us as fathers, spiritual fathers, because you have your biological father, but then you can have thousands or millions of children as a spiritual father. You feel what I'm saying? There's people right now worshiping a spiritual father by the name of Pope Francis.
Right.
But he's dealing with a darker spiritual. He's a false god.
Right.
But that's their spiritual father. So those people, you have to be aware of that. That they consider that their father. And by proxy they adhere to the mind state and everything. It's almost like a download.
Right.
You download something, you don't know, it might be malware and all kind of shit in it. But when you download that, you said that's your father, everything that comes with that comes into your spirit.
I totally agree with you, brother. You know, and I think that a lot of us overlook the power that we have to teach. And I teach in the streets, man. I wanted to be known. This is where I teach at. You know what I'm saying? I have to go in the street, man, where the war is actually at, man, where you can actually see the self-destruction mentality and activation. You can actually see what has happened to us, not in the lecture hall, but in the street, where they're dying, where they're killing each other, where they're not eating proper foods, where they're not doing a lot of things. And my young brother right here is going to help me along the way, because he's learning what he has to do in this world to make amends for what he may have not done in the last world that my brother was speaking about. And this is his friend right here. I'm dealing with the youth. So I want that to be known. I'm teaching the babies.
That's your foundation, though.
That's right. You're right.
Coming from the school of Allah, that is your foundation. It was always in the streets, especially with the gods in the earth. I was telling somebody yesterday, when I was in C-74, the dude that had the whole goddamn jail shook was a god, Fruquan. He had his own, he had his own mod by himself in the adolescent jail. Was a god body. So it was a street thing. But if he came in the yard and dropped knowledge, everything that he was saying was being absorbed because he had power. So all I'm saying is the foundation of the gods in the earth is the street knowledge, street organization. We sway from that.
And I would add to that too, very eloquent of you, is it's very important to build that connection and continue to spark these young men, because I was on Nostrand Avenue, I was on the A-train, and there were three young brothers like yourself, and there was another person that wasn't in his right state of mind, so he was acting out, and I said, oh man, now these three young brothers, I'm thinking that these dudes are gonna, you know, right. They observed him, you know what they did? They looked at him, they got up, and they walked away. And I walked up to the brothers, I said, you know what? I like how you guys handled yourself. I like the fact that you didn't allow him to embroil you into a situation that will end up on World Star Hip Hop. And that is something that's really is powerful, when we can take and plant seeds in these young men and be able to guide them. Because ultimately, I remember there was a dude back in the 70s that used to take me to the park, buy donuts and all this stuff, and we would talk about life, and he had a very powerful impact on keeping me out of trouble. You know what I mean? So never underestimate the value of how you can connect with these younger people. Like I said, I welcome all your questions. Whatever questions you have, I welcome that. I'm sure he welcomes that, because ultimately when people are walking around here with questions, they get in trouble. These 64 squares that you see right here, the chess table, I subscribe everybody to learn how to play chess. Chess is the game of life, and a lot of people don't use this. The benefits of chess, right, is 64 squares. So the premise of it is time, space, force, and pawn structure. If you can get from the middle game to the end game, those faculties will follow you into other areas of how you think and how you entertain things. There's a guy named Maurice Astley who was a grandmaster. When he used to come home from school, from 14 to 22, all he did was play chess. He would do his homework, get a little something to eat, and then he would play 4 or 5 hours of chess. And because he did that, he's commanding a six-figure salary where Fortune 500 companies give him their books of their quarterlies, ask him to evaluate the patterns of what's going on, what the projections would possibly be, and they cut him a check. So the faculties of chess that he learned, that he honed all those years, are paying him wonderful dividends right now because he knows how to think from, most people think from A to C, maybe A to F. But thinking from A to Z is a valuable commodity that most people do not afford themselves to have, right? So playing chess will give you that advantage, and it will allow you to learn how to think your way around certain obstacles, situations, and trouble that we seem to find ourselves in effortlessly. So I advocate for everybody to learn how to play chess, cultivate that. My young guy, my youngest guy is right there, Isaiah. He learned. How old were you when you learned how to play chess?
How old were you?
Five.
He learned how to play chess when he was five. I made sure that he knew how to play chess. Now this dude is a city kid. He goes to a very ebullient school. He's in the seventh grade, but he's doing like 12th grade work. And he's extremely ingenious because he was inculcated by his father how to think. And that's the benefit and the privilege that we have as black men. You don't have to just be your sons that you're teaching how to think, but anybody that you have access to, right? And that's the reason why your platform is invaluable. Sa.Netr's platform is invaluable. Your platform is super invaluable because you're out here face to face with people. When people come to my workshops and my presentations, lectures, and seminars, you know what happens? Sometimes people see my eyes change colors from the color that it is now to green. When I was in London, I was doing an altar workshop, and there were three women in the audience that had bad eyesight. I found out about this by accident because Wendy from London calls me up and says, Gano, one of my friends said, do you wear colored contact lenses? I said, no. Why do you ask? She said, because she was sitting in the back and she saw your eyes were glowing green. And two other people said that. And I said, So when I went into meditation, the reason that I asked my agency, why did that happen? I said, number one, it was a real thing. We chose three women with bad eyesight because, first of all, they're women. Women are the divine feminine. We chose the women with bad eyesight to heighten the fact that what actually happened happened because they saw it. And it was three, the divine frequency trinity triad of three. And we also wanted you to know that we are with you. So a lot of times when in the physicality of when you build with these young gods, right, you're not just giving them words. You're giving them energy that is unseen. And you're downloading that energy into these brothers. And when these brothers find themselves in a situation sometimes, they're going to think back on your words, wisdom of what you've taught them. Peace, King. Right? And they're going to make a different choice. That's the reason why. And I never got a chance to do that decode with the NWA movie. But one of the things that I loved it. One of the things that I saw in that movie that was so deep, right? Did you see the movie? You know what I took away from that movie overall? Was Dr. Dre and Ice Cube are the two guys that walked away. They made the decision to look at the tapestry in the diaspora and say, and then they had to deal with the character of who they were as men and say, you know what? I'd rather walk away from a headache than to live in a nightmare. I don't care about how much money I'm walking away from. I'm going to walk away from this with my life, with my dignity. Tina Turner did the same thing. I'll leave with my... So there's a valuable lesson in three people, Tina Turner, Dr. Dre, and Ice Cube. They walked away from everything that they had amassed. And what did they get in return? Quadruple, triple. They got many, many times more than what they walked away from because they had the character. The character. The character is, who are you when nobody's looking? What would you do if you see $100 hanging out of somebody's pocket? White or black? Are you going to go up to them and be like, or are you going to say, excuse me, you have some money hanging out of your pocket? That's character. So when the unseen kingdom sees that, and they give you those tests every day. Some tests are more powerful than others, but when they see that you made that right choice, you know what's on the other side of that? More power. Right? We are tested all the time.
It's like being in school, like he's saying. We could start in elementary with a Christian in a Christian belief system, but as we go into the university, you know, as we go higher in the ranks, your tests are going to be more intricate. And the same way that if you pass a test, you know, you get to go to the next grade, or you get to, you know, have a certain kind of grade score during class, when you pass life's tests, you are going to now, life unfolds for you. That you will be introduced, you'll be introduced to new concepts. You'll be able to be introduced into new energy and things of that nature. So when you pass your test, that's, you know, that's how you grow.
This is my brother. I love my brother right here. no, I don't do it like that. So, yes.
What do you feel about slavery? Do you think that this gentleman over here, do you think he escaped the paradigms of slavery on what he's teaching?
You said, do I think he's what?
Did he escape the paradigm of slavery to what he's teaching and what you know of it?
I mean, I just met him. I don't know him. But the entire goal of slavery was to keep black people in a position of subjugation and make sure that they were psychologically weak. So from what I see, there's no real, I don't know him well enough to really judge, but from what I see, there's no psychological weaknesses. Brothers weren't supposed to help other brothers out, and they were supposed to be separate from each other. He's clearly not separate from us. Like, he's here to help people out, from what I see. So long story short, I feel like he's escaped the paradigm as far as my vision goes.
What do you feel about that, brother?
What do I feel?
Yes.
Well, as I can see, to piggyback off what he says, it's true. Like, he's clearly mentally strong. Psychologically, he's not weak. So, yeah, he has escaped the paradigms of white supremacy with slavery. So there.
We don't get a peek into his subconscious, so we don't know subconsciously how he operates. You feel me? So he may speak to us and deal with us in a certain manner and fashion, but in the back of his mind, I'm not gonna say he's thinking something different, but the way he operates stems from some kind of psychological scar, something we don't know him. But from what I see, as far as my vision extends, yeah, he out here to help us. He's escaped the paradigm as far as we've spoken. Uh-huh.
Come on, man. That's an insult, man.
No.
Black men,
it's not an insult. Like,
yeah.
How you
find
that?
Yeah. Right.
It's not an insult. Like, that thing I said about Jesus. Like, every image is associated with a logic and a perception. So therefore, if you see the image of Jesus, and every time you see a white man, he's good, he's great, and he's divine, you may attribute everything white with divinity. Like, if some black men speak intelligently, and, you know, sometimes your subconscious may leak certain information out about you. If some black men speak intelligently, they may say, oh, you speak white. So that means you associate speaking properly with speaking white. Or if brothers say, oh, I got that white money, that means that you associate great wealth with whiteness. So I'm saying, subconsciously, you may have certain psychological scars that associate color with profit or with things that are attributed, I mean, that are deemed positive. So I'm saying, he may have a psychological scar in a certain sense where, because you can't recognize subconscious things. They're not necessarily superficial. Conscious information is what people have control over. Subconscious things are the slip-ups, and that's how you really recognize an individual. So for instance, he may have a psychological scar that we may not recognize, but we could see it based on the way that he deals with us. I haven't seen anything, but I'm just saying, based on the based on what we're speaking about, I haven't seen anything from him.
I think that, and with all due respect to what you're saying, we're optical creatures, which means that we predominantly gauge people by what we see. And what is presented forth is what we go by until someone opens their mouth, and then we have something else to go by. Or we may observe how someone smells. That's another thing. So we're using our senses to gauge who someone is. There were killers that are walking around, and I could tell. They got that certain look. I go, you got a couple of bodies. I know that. I also know perverts when I see them. When you live long enough, you're able to read someone's, the nuances of the character. So if you live long enough, and I hope that you do, you're going to be able to accurately identify all of the people that are around you. I've talked to thousands and thousands of people all around the world, and I could tell when somebody, hold on, I could tell when somebody is not processing what I'm saying. I could tell when they cut off. I could tell when they're with me and when they're not. My whole point is that in this point in your life, and this goes for all of you who are 16 and under, it's important that you absorb all that you can from the older gods, the older brothers, the elder brothers, because honestly, right now, and I'm really sad to think that we're living in the last generation. I grew up in the 70s and the 80s, right? So the people who were older back then, we're like connected. Like this generation dies, that generation that dies off, that had their connection with the great-great-grands, it's not going to be anymore after them. So when we lost Percy Sutton, and we lost John Henry Clark, and we lost Sheikh Anta Diop, we lost our physical connection to some of the giants that, back in the days in Harlem, and I'm making a point, it said that when you lived in Harlem back in the 50s and the 60s, there was always a grandmother in the household, and the grandchildren would have to entertain the family on Sundays. And it was a custom and a tradition that we've lost sight of. So the black family has always been under attack consistently since then. What's my point? My point is the God here is building with the younger gods on a regular basis. He's taking them under their wing and he's teaching them. You teach them how to play chess as well?
Not yet.
Okay, not yet. Okay. But they're going to get there eventually. The benefit of that is it affects all of us. And there's also a spiritual recompense called Dharma. When you're somebody, when you refer to Father Allah, he had the Dharma of awakening an entire populace of people that would mentally have been asleep had he not come with the supreme alphabets in the mathematics, right? So the Dharma that is associated with someone that awakens other people, I tell people all the time, I have lots of free videos on YouTube that are a hodgepodge of, right? Now Rule, Turtle Games, and then Boom Bap Nation has filmed a lot of what I've done, and I put them free what it is that I have to offer. If you really want to test the soup and have the proof in the pudding, it's not dealing with spookism, come to a workshop and ask me any question that you have. Let me give you the direction, the ritual, and the pathway, because we spend too much time arguing about Kemet was this, the Hebrews were that, and the Bible, we're using a comic book, which I refer to the Bible as, no disrespect to people that live by it, but that is an archaic, outdated machination that people live their lives by to this day in 2015 to the letter. And it's not for that purpose. It was to enslave you. And so if you don't graduate from that formation of thought that the Bible has, and I can give you many, many proofs of this, you are basically wasting your time. It has a benefit to a certain degree, but you have to grow outside of that. And like I said, it represents a second grade education. So people that are fighting about things in the Bible, you guys are second graders kicking each other in the shins, and it doesn't make any sense because there are other things that are going on that are affecting you that you need to come out of. You had a question?
You said it was meant to enslave you, right? Meant to enslave you in what way?
Oh, in every way. Religion, all the wars that have been fought on this planet were under the auspices of Christianity. when this place was taken over, it was because of Christianity. We must force you to take this religion, because if you don't take the religion, we can't enslave you. We can't program you. We can't control you. So it is an enslavement of epic proportions, mentally, spiritually, and physically.
So,
and financially as well.
So do you think, so let me ask you a question. Do you think the Bible or Christianity is evil?
That's a dualistic question, and the dichotomy is that the precept of what Christianity is about, the formation of thought, Christ consciousness, Christos, that's all good, right? But the imperative of spiritual degradation and the holy wars and the Spanish Inquisition and the medieval times
that you see right now, and the Pope,
I didn't say he did. So, right? With all of that being said, there's an overall damaging effect that goes beyond generations when people can't see beyond it. And the symbols of that are things that people pray to every day. So the source that you have in you that will give you the power to illuminate two cities, which is the etheric part of you, if you learn how to get in contact with it, it has enough electricity in it that it can empower a lot electrically. You give that, not you, but people that pray to a certain icon, I'm not going to say what it is, but hopefully you can see where I'm coming from. You're giving away your own divine resource to something that is not giving it back to you. So your next question might be like, well, what about all the people in church that are praying, that are saying, and they get their prayers answered? It's not them that's doing it. It's not the, no, it's not, excuse me, it's not the,
so let me ask you a question.
It's their own intrinsic power that's doing it from a deeper level.
That was basically going to be my question, because I personally feel like divinity limits your, religion limits your perception of your divinity. So, because of the fact that they shape what God is supposed to be, omnipresent, omnipotent, and omniscientific, you feel like God must be able to do everything, and you feel like he must be able to create everything in an instant. And there must be a Most High, or there can be a Most High, but I personally feel like I'm a God, just like everyone in this circle is a God. It's all about perception. But, I think at the end of the day, it's all science. It's just science that's not understood. Like, in quantum physics, they could prove that thoughts exist as wavelengths. So if they're wavelengths, they exist on a vibratory level. So now, if I think a thought, your chakras absorb vibratory energy. So if I think a thought, based on our toroidal field, your magnetism can naturally, obtain my thought, and your chakras will absorb that vibratory wavelength. So long story short, I think it's all science, but it's just not understood. I don't even understand it completely. I'm only 16, but I don't even understand it completely. So when you say, people pray to Jesus and some of their prayers get answered and Jesus wasn't answering it, I personally don't think the other God was answering it. I think everyone answers their own prayers. Even if you think about the law of attraction, some of it is very, very logical. I think we just mystify it a little too much. Like, if I think something enough, naturally that thought crystallizes into habit. Once it becomes habit, it can gradually become action. That action inevitably becomes habit. And once that action becomes a habit, it's solidified into my character. My character defines my destiny. So some of it is just, I think it's just logic, but we mystify it a little too much.
Let me get in. And I hear what you're saying. I was in London last year. The second time I was there, I was walking down the block and I turned the corner. And I saw a snail, very much out of his shell, and I could, I just happened to look down, I saw the snail, and the snail was striving to get across the sidewalk. In a nanosecond, I made the discernment that if I don't help this snail, somebody else is going to come around the corner and crush him. So I bent down, and I picked up the snail, and I said, hey, little fella, and I walked him to a yard, and I put him where he was safe, at the base of a tree. I came out 2 days later, and the snail was still there. So my point is, figuratively speaking, we are gods in an embryonic state. We are not gods yet. The same way that the acorn is not a tree. The acorn has a full-grown tree inside of it. Hold on.
So you're saying we have the potential for divinity, but we're not divine?
No. The potential is 97% dormant within you. Science will tell you that, right? They don't know why the genes are there. They don't know why these codes are there. They don't know what to do with it. Science can't even accurately measure ether. So you have solid, liquid, gas, ether, 1, 2, 3, and 4. The spaceships that are up here, we can't see because they're in ether 3 and 4. And it's a fact. I've been on them. So there are things that are going on all around you that you can't see. So if you're asking me to prove the validity of who these beings are, what they're able to do, I would give you a ritual or a galactic coordinate that says if you do this or if you take this amalgamation, that'll be the proof right there. The same way I really can't prove what electricity is, but it doesn't mean it's not there. The oxygen is not seeable, but it is here. So in terms of being a god, we could call ourselves that, but we haven't grown into the fullness of it, or else we would not be 97% dormant. There are things that we have to do in order to expand the fullness, and that takes lifetimes for us. And if somebody hasn't even mastered their own life, like where they live, how they're going to gain money and all of these things, how could you possibly, the economic status of who you are, you cannot really claim sovereignty, and I'm talking about cosmic sovereignty over your own life. You have to control everything about yourself. Let me talk about Paul Robeson. You ever heard of Paul Robeson? Check him out. Paul Robeson was somebody in the 1800s who was a lawyer, an actor, an accomplished Shakespearean actor. Hold on, I'm making a point. Also, he played football, basketball. He was an opera singer. He spoke 26 languages. He did all of these things at a time when white folks had their feet on our necks. But those same white folks was like, "We love you, Paul Robeson." Why is that? So when you study somebody like Paul Robeson, and you said something earlier that I'm explicifying now. Have I broken the paradigm of the effects of slavery? Yes, I have. Even back then, Jack Johnson was somebody else that walked with Carl Blanche, was beating white folks up at a time where if you look at a white woman, you can get hung up from a tree. How was it possible that somebody like Jack Johnson had the autonomy and the carte blanche to be able to do something like that? So karma has a lot to do with that blessing that he had to be able to pummel and beat up on white folks at a time where we couldn't do anything.
So you're saying he ascended to his divinity?
No. Ascending to your divinity means hold on. Okay, hold on. Let me answer one question at a time. Ascending to your divinity means that you no longer have the use for a physical uniform called the body, and you've outgrown the use for it. That actually is the literal version and definition behind ascending to your divinity. I teach people how to do that. Anybody that's in human form, you're still in school. You can't disappear like this. There's a video that I have on Galacticus.com on YouTube. At the end of the video, the name of the video, and I challenge all of you to watch it. The video is called What My Mother Lakshmi Told Me. Mm-hmm. I put a picture of Lakshmi on there, and the video is 10:19. Now, you know when you put videos up, it's hard to control what the timestamp is going to be. And I'll share this with you. My birthday is at 10:19. So who gives birth to you is your mother. So I said, wait a minute. I didn't even know that to the end of the video. The video has a picture of Lakshmi, and I put My Mother Lakshmi. Who gives birth to you? Your mother. Then, at the end of the video, I disappear. I had nothing to do with that. I didn't even see that till I uploaded and I looked at the video and I said, oh, snap, I disappeared. Did you see that video?
Not yet.
Had nothing to do with that. So my point is, the goddess Lakshmi, who is my divine mother, and I have the great privilege of knowing that in this lifetime, wanted to show me that, yes, I am your mother, and you are already an ascended being. That's why I disappear at the end of the video. There's another No, I'm not saying that. Not an ascended master. Am I ascended being? I've already ascended in another lifetime. Yes, and I came back to teach other people how to do it. That's right. That's right.
So let me ask you a question. So you say you've ascended, right? So if you've ascended and you've came back to teach us, that means you know about your past reincarnation or you don't?
I know about a few of them, the ones that are most important. I've chosen not to know the lesser importance
The same way that I... Okay, yeah, I will. Okay. Right. I know about a few of them, but I've chosen not to know because we all have a hard drive, and I don't want my hard drive cluttered with the superfluous, extraneous, mundane lifetimes. I only need to know the highlights, but yes, I do know those.
So,
let me ask you a question. What would you do? What would you do to elevate the black man spiritually?
That's a great question. I'm so happy that you asked. Pass these around, please. Pass these flies around. And I'm going to answer your question with this action, right? Yeah, pass these around. What would I do to elevate the black man? I'm already doing it. You listening? Mm-hmm. Been doing it. This is one of them. This is a empowerment that I'm giving to anyone who's ready to have more power. And all of my proof is on YouTube in terms of the videos and everything else. I allow the people to talk about what their experiences are and has been. Sa.Netr, that's right and exact. And also, yeah, it's small. It's not big enough. But on the next one, Sa.Netr, we got to do something at the National Black Theater. Because, okay, then we can have vendors. Yes, then. And also, this is another thing that I'm doing. This is the main thing, brother. The altar workshop is probably one of my biggest gifts to any area of their life, because I don't want to debate about silly things, but I would rather give you the keys, the codes, the tools, the ritual. And he could tell you, because he's been to my workshops before, he's been to my presentations, as can Boom Bap over there. They could all tell you. So the answer to my, to your question, but the answer to what it is that I have to offer is in the doing. And I've had workshops, seminars, presentations, lectures. I've been all around the world helping our people to do that. Now, if somebody comes across this flyer and they look at it and they say, I'd rather go to a club, that's on them. But I'm putting it out here. I'm in Harlem now and I'm building with all of you. I put the flyers out there. I put the free videos out there. I have the website. What else can I do?
Right? I looked at the flyer and the fee was the fee was $100 at the door.
That's right.
That's per person, right?
That's right.
You expect black people to buy that?
Yes, I do. And that will be, and that place will be jam-packed. Now, hold on. I can tell you're dealing with the spirit of lack. Spirit of lack when someone cannot entertain paying $100 to get something that's going to change their life. You must, hold on. You must come out of that. Because white people charge $1,500 for far less than what it is that I'm giving. You got to come out of that spirit of lack, brother, because spirit of lack is like when you can't entertain paying your people for a service that they're providing you. You're too young to be ensnared in that spirit of lack, brother. And poverty consciousness is something that afflicts our people because we're cheap. We always want I don't have no money. We got to come up out of that. That's ridiculous. Go ahead.
Poverty consciousness, man. That's one thing we definitely got to get out of that. When you look at these so-called Jews in their universities, do you know how much it costs just to buy one of their books? How much it costs for them to teach a class? If you was to come out here on Saturdays, listen to me for a minute. The young people be lined up on the corner, ready to go into them goddamn stores to get $300 pair of sneakers that ain't gonna do a damn thing for them. You see what I'm saying? So when you say, will our people pay for that? Yes, they will.
Let me say,
Hold on. Hold on, young God. Because I want to reiterate what poverty consciousness is. If you hopped out of a Bentley right now, the people supposed to applaud that.
That's right.
Because it shows that he sold a certain amount of information to our people that could not even afford him a Bentley, but could afford him multiple things, and he didn't sell drugs. But our minds are conditioned, especially the youth and especially the younger generations, that the OGs didn't teach the lessons that the elders taught us, that poverty consciousness was that nigga supposed to hop out of a fucking Benz if he's selling crack. He's supposed to hop out of a Ghost if he's selling work. That means he's supposed to sell over, his shit's supposed to be in overdrive. But polite hopping out of something European or foreign and he's selling books, that shit is a problem. Like,
right.
Oh my goodness, what's going on in Harlem? What are they doing? Like, you know what I mean? So they want to keep us with a fucking cup in our hand to prove that we are down with the people. That's poverty consciousness. That's poverty consciousness. Poverty consciousness supposed to be, yo, I want to pay you a buck because of information that I received from you. Who respects anything that they get for free? That's why some of these videos don't do the results that they're supposed to do, because we pitching pearls, we dropping million-dollar information, but niggas is getting it for free. So they didn't pay $100 for this information. But when you sit in front of them crackers, a buck and up, you got to give them a rack, $1,500 for downstairs information. So we got to break that cycle.
That's right.
Active. Let me get
it off. Israel in the house. Israel in the house.
Peace, Kings.
Israel.
Shalom.
Illogical ones. So I meant to say this.
Right.
When I said that, I meant to say this. Me being outside, I would pay $100 to come hear what you have to say. But that's me, right? I already have a preconception that you out here to help me. You feeding me positive information. But coming outside of that, if I don't know you in any way, shape, or form, and you presenting information, why would I come to you and pay $100 for information that could potentially be useless?
I'm so glad that you asked that question. And the answer to your question is, and by the way, this is $300 for the Kundalini Reiki initiation. So that's really going to freak you out. But to answer your question, I have here on the bottom of the flyer, subscribe to the Galacticus.com YouTube channel. My track record is already established. There are people all around the world who I've done miracles for. I could put my hands on everybody around here in less than 10 seconds and give everybody the energy of a miracle. And I've done it. The reason I stopped doing it as much as I used to is because people don't appreciate it. There was a guy that I met that had full-blown, I don't know what he had, but you can tell when somebody's hair starts thinning and they're losing a lot of weight and they have to wear 3 or 4 pairs of pants underneath. And I walked up to the brother and I said, "Brother, do you mind if I give you a miracle?" He looked at me and said, "Yes." So I did what I did. A couple of weeks later, my old girlfriend saw that same guy who was on death's door. And he had gained all of his weight back. His hair was full. And she said, "Gano, I saw that guy that you gave the blessing to. He said he's in remission and he's good." And I said, "It was because he received a miracle." So my point is, if you go to YouTube or if you go to my website, my credential is there. And you pose a very good question, because why should you pay me $100 to come to an altar workshop? Hold on. Right, I got you. Let me answer the question.
Why shouldn't I buy my
spirit? Why should you?
Talk about spirit.
Well, that's a good, because your priorities are messed up. I'm going to tell you, right?
I'm not saying
right,
specifically.
Right. Whoever that applies to,
I'm saying the average,
the priorities,
poverty,
the priority,
why would he come,
like, of our people, uh-huh, if we're going to spend $100 to $300 on a pair of sneakers, but we would look at something like this and say, "That costs $300. I can't afford that." But you can still afford those sneakers that is not giving you a modicum, a fraction of what it is that I'm offering you. That's being under the influence of slave consciousness right there. Slave mentality. Hold on. Let me make my point. No. Hold on.
$300 for the feet.
Right.
Versus $300 for the crown. You make the choice. Which one you going to invest in? The brain?
So when we start investing when we start investing and we get our priorities straight, and hear my point. There are people I know, right? You know what they do? Instead of buying a home, they'll buy a Benz and live in the projects. That's having your priorities screwed up. There is a natural order to what it is that we should be doing with the power of our finances. And it's something that I also teach people. So if someone has $200, right, and they would rather buy a pair of sneakers, or they would rather buy a fitted or something like, instead of taking that same money and supporting not only their local business, but coming to something like this where they can get the answers of how to get more of that, then that also is a mindset that needs to be addressed. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay.
But I just feel like this. who are you really preaching to when the black people that have $100 to come to your door are coming? You preaching to the choir. Because the people that actually want to come...
Hey, yo, yo, everybody move back this way. That's why it's getting crowded. Because, yeah, spread it out. Spread it out. Now y'all can move in. Move in. Move in.
The people that actually want to come already have a conceived notion in their mind of what they're receiving. So if I'm from a poverty-stricken neighborhood and there are pressures closing in on me from all angles, and you teaching me about spirit, how can I convince a spiritually ignorant black man to come to learn about spirit when he sees no immediate effect for him, or when he has to do a whole bunch of searching before he can actually get an answer? Even from what you tell him, he has to do a, like, even if the value system is fucked up, it's understandable, because it's just like, okay, I live in a house, I don't have a lot of money, but the money I do have, I don't want to spend it on something. I'm just saying, coming from their mindset, I don't want to spend it on something that could potentially be useless.
Right.
So therefore, if I do spend it on mine, because we spend a lot of money on the education system, we spend a lot of money to learn garbage. So what if I'm coming to you and I'm learning garbage? How do I know that what you're teaching me isn't garbage? And you said you are credible, we can go to your website, but I'm saying if I'm from the projects, or if I'm from wherever, what is the importance of your spiritual information to me relative to my new pair of sneakers? Like,
are you letting me answer the question?
Yes.
Okay. The answer to the question is, like I said before, it's really, I can't go into your mind and fix, hear me out, or anyone this applies to, not just you, but anybody across the board, because it's a great question that you pose. But what I'm saying is, if someone prioritizes a pair of sneakers in juxtaposition to something that is going to give them a lot more, so that they can get the sneakers and everything else, I'm going to answer that question. You got to listen, brother. I'm not finished yet. The reason that I have the website that I have, with the faces on it, with the testimonials from everyone who has experienced, that has come to my workshops and lectures and everything else, they talking for themselves. Not only that, but the videos that I have over 100 videos on there. The reason that I put on the flyer, subscribe to the Galacticus Film Channel, because it's part of you doing due diligence. So if somebody says, yeah, come to my workshop for $100 or $300, the first thing you should do is say, who are you? And that's what you're doing. I like that. Why should I come? Why should I pay you $100 to come? Excellent. That's the beginning of intellect. It's the beginning of wisdom. But I'm answering the question. So the next part is, take that flyer home, right? You have a computer, right? And I don't mean from your phone. Do it from a desktop. Go to galacticus.com. Go to the testimonials page and read the testimonies and see what it does to your spirit. Go to the YouTube channel, galacticus.com, G-A-L-I-G-H-T, and look at any of the videos. See how you feel after you see one. What will happen is, the energy of your soul will say, wow, okay, that's the truth. I can't argue with that. I want to know more. Because we all have an internal barometer. Tell when somebody's deceiving us or lying to us, or we should be able to, right? When we look at somebody, we can say, I don't like that person. It's because you're feeling and looking at the energy of who that person really is. Also, when you're drawn to someone, the same thing is also true. So to answer your question, go to the website. Check out my credulous and my credentials, because it's all there. And see, and if you don't rock with it, that's fine. That's cool, because it might not resonate with you. But for most of people that do hear me speak, or that have benefited from what it is that I have taught them, they have had results that draw money to them, that give them purpose of their life, that they're able to connect with their divine parents, they're able to connect with their ancestors. They have all of the, as you say, good luck, good fortune, serendipity, and all of the other things that come with what it is that I provide with the workshops. And that is the answer to your question.
So I want to ask you another question. Can psychology or mind state cause you to neglect spiritual information?
Psychology can, psychology, Freudian psychology, to answer your question, right? Do you want me to answer the question?
Of course I do.
Okay. So collegiate psychology, book psychology, can severely impair your spirituality, because the two are two completely different schools of thought. So academia, what?
So you saying you can't learn spirituality from books or?
Oh, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand that. So you saying you can't learn spirituality from books?
No, I'm not saying that. There's a lot of books that are written on spirituality, but you said psychology. Psychology is predominantly taught in academia, in college, in school, Board of Education. What I'm saying is when you are regimented into certain psychology that comes with the Board of Education, it is an indoctrination into a way of thinking not freely, which is something that you have to learn and get out of and liberate yourself, and they're not giving you that in school. So when people come out of college, they don't often entertain their spirituality because they become very linear. 1, 2, 3, 4, and I have to get a job over here, and they become automatrons, and that happens a lot. When someone has the freedom to be a spiritual person, they operate on a different frequency, and they operate on a different path, and they have a lot more freedom.
That's what it sounds
no,
like.
Not really.
Because you're saying the education process caused you to
limit. There's a benefit.
You're saying the education process caused you to limit what you entertain, right?
No. No.
But you said they wouldn't entertain it.
The answer to your question was what could possibly happen if you asked me if psychology
or mind state
affects your ability to be spiritual. Yes. So I answered that question already. Do you have another question about that? Or
I basically said that.
Two more questions, that's it.
Okay.
All right, so you're
cool.
Gonna be on the road.
Oh, you're I basically.
Yeah, that's fine. Does anybody else have a question, though? Because I want to get some.
Cool. I basically said that. Yeah.
Yeah.
I just said that to say, like he said, go on his website. I believe everything he's saying. I feel like he really out here to help. But I'm just playing the devil's advocate. Like, he said, go on his website and check out what's on his website and see how it affects my spirit. The reason I asked if psychology or mind state can affect you, like, can affect how you receive spirituality or cause spiritual neglect, is because if I'm already Christian, my mind is already psychologically colonized. So now, if you present an information that originates from Kemet or any African origin, psychologically or mentally, I'm conditioned already.
Right.
I'm already indoctrinated in the European system.
Right.
So now, if you present an African information to me, based on my psychological mind state, I may neglect the spiritual information you possess because I already possess some Christian spirituality.
Right.
That's the reason I asked you that. So I'm saying, I say that to say this. When I asked you about the young kid from Brownsville or the young kid from anywhere, when he says, why should I go to your workshop instead of pay for my sneakers? And you say, you know, what I'm giving you, I'm paraphrasing what you said, what I'm giving you is worth a lot more than those sneakers. I'm giving you those sneakers in abundance.
Exactly.
With the spirituality I'm feeding you.
Exactly.
Now, understanding communities that are in poverty, 9 times out of 10, if your community's in poverty, there's probably 9 churches in your neighborhood. All those churches deal with Christianity. So therefore, how open would those kids be to receive that spiritual African information that you're presenting when their mind is already psychologically colonized?
All right, good question. I want y'all to give it up for our young brother, Marcus. 16 years old. You don't hear teenagers, 16 years old. You don't hear teenagers asking questions like this. So one more time, man. Give it up for this young brother, 16 years old. He brought some strong questions, and my brother just got to be wise enough to answer the questions. That's it. You know what I'm saying? Let's give it up for our brother, Gano. I want you to answer his last question, brother. And then we want to go to our sister. She want to ask you a question.
Oh, you know, no, I got it. Okay. So, it's a great question. The answer to the question is Christianity is not what I'm teaching. Religion is not what I'm teaching. Spirituality is above and beyond the inculcation of Christianity. So, what I challenge people to do, and the reason that I put together my website and the YouTube channel, because I realized that the younger brothers from Brownsville are always on, and they could easily go and they could say, let me see what this brother Gano Grills is talking about. Spirituality, rituals, $100, $300. And they look and then they see something, they're like, oh. Now, 90% of the people that look at my videos usually have the same response, which is, I've never heard that before. I never thought about it like that before. You sparked my brain cell. I want to know more. I consult people all the time. People pay me $150 an hour for a consultation. people will happily pay me. And then when I ask them if they're happy at the end, I'm very happy. And then they become an initiate. They become a student. They become a... Because now that they've gone beyond that. If I was not decorated in what it is that I have to offer, and what I had to offer is was not and is not of value, there's no way that that would be possible. So what do? I put my credence and credulous on the website, and I wouldn't be able to stand in here in Harlem, right here in Harlem, in front of all of you if I didn't have that to back it up. So for the young kid in Brownsville that would rather spend $100 on his sneakers and say, you know what, I don't feel like going to that thing, it's cost $100, I'd rather do that. I would say, if you juxtapose and compare, what are the sneakers going to do outside of maybe a couple of people say, wow, I like those kicks, man, that's tight. Or a girl come up to you and say, you know, those sneakers are so beautiful, here's my phone number, call me. But what I'm offering to other people is something that goes way beyond that, and it is for people to come out of their struggle, for people to connect to other parts of themselves that they did not know existed, and hopefully put those people on a path of enlightenment, which will be far more valuable than those $100, $200, $300.
Hold up, listen to what I'm saying. You're missing the point. I never said these people weren't African. I'm saying if we're gonna talk about who people are, why can't we be specific? So we can get to the bottom of this and speak intelligently, because when we start throwing blankets over it, when you say Africa, you're talking about multiple cultures, multiple religions, multiple belief systems. So all I'm saying is, if we're gonna talk about this in an intelligent way, let's deal with the highest form of this intelligence, right? That's all I'm saying.
Facts. At that point, after you saying that, I don't really got nothing to argue with you about. I just thought, because what Sa.Netr said was, you are not African, you are not a continent.
And I see the logic in what he's saying, right? I do see the logic in what he's saying, because a hyena is African, right? So are you the same as a hyena? Okay,
but don't I use you know I'm human. You see me.
It's the point. It's the point. Let me just say this, and I hear what you're saying. The point that he made is very logical. It makes a lot of sense, and is rooted in reality of the fact that there are different. Because Africa's a continent of over 50 something countries. Am I right? Over 2,000 different languages, customs, cultures, spiritual systems. So there's no one anything in Africa. Okay, that's an actual fact. But what we have to do in order to bridge the point that we're trying to make, for instance, we call ourselves Pan-African. Well, I do. I'm a Pan-Africanist. A lot of our people, we say Pan-African. You know, a lot of these, we had a Pan-African conference last summer. You know, it was not a Pan-Continentalist conference. You know what I mean? So a lot of times what we do is we get caught up in a lot of word semantics and we miss points. A lot of times we get so deep, we become shallow. You know, because for people that have been robbed of a knowledge of self, taken from their tribal customs, spiritual customs, mixed, have been amalgamated and have been whitewashed, colonialized, reindoctrinated, and have been given different social constructs as identity. For us to say that you can't say you're from this place, you have to specifically say where you're from to a people who have been robbed of that knowledge, and not starting with the basis. Yeah, we come from that landmass, and from there as a basis or premise to start from, then we navigate into the knowledge of who we are and define who we are. Okay? But we have to stop. We have to stop being shallow. We can't become so deep that we're so deep that we're just spaced out and we're not on earth dealing with reality no more, because we're so far into a whole nother stratosphere of in-depth knowledge. And I'm saying that in general, because I hear a lot of people, we're not African, we're this. Then they go into the word semantics of what Africa is. Okay, let's take the name Africa out of the equation. Some people might say Leo Scipio's Africanus, 212 AD, the Punic Wars, it was called that after it was colonialized as a colonial name. Let's take that off. Let's take away Akibolon. Some people might have discrepancies with that. Okay? Some people might say, oh no, Abyssinia, let's take away that. That's Greek. However, the landmass is a starting point, because our people are so psychologically duped into thinking they're not even from that landmass. even though science has proven that the oldest art, writing, relics of human Homo sapiens are found there in that region, we can use that as a basic foundation to say where we spawn from and where we come from. Finding out who we are specifically is predicated upon the fact that we come from that landmass to start with, is all I'm trying to say. We have to bridge the gap. We can't just say we're African. We have to find out who we specifically are, but that's the starting point.
But to a certain extent, I put it like this. What you do when you start saying things like,
what you do when you start saying things like
you're not African or you're not a continent. Once you start telling people they're not African, you start perpetuating division. And the reason you perpetuate division is because if he asks, like for instance, this brother right here, when they ask, are you from Africa? And he says, no, I'm from Mali. Or he's, yeah, exactly. So,
African Americans telling Africans.
No, I'm saying, when he says, hold on, brother. Yeah.
One at a time.
When he said, you perpetuate division when you do things like that. Because
talk to him right over there with the phone.
Hold on.
He said, I understand what you're saying, but we in New York, and that's what the people know us as Africans. He said, we are in New York.
But did I not say that?
He's right over there. So I said, in Mali, do you walk around and say, I'm African? They say, no. We call ourselves by our tribe.
Just tell you the thing about it is, if I'm in America, hold on. If I'm in America, I'm not going to say, if I'm in America, I'm not. Yeah, exactly.
So, the
way you, hold on, brother. Let me finish my point. Hold on.
Say I'm an American. They still say that. But what I'm saying is,
if you're in a bubble on the continent,
they don't say I'm African.
Hey, listen. That's like saying, hold up. That's like saying this. If you're in New York and somebody says where you're from, you're not gonna say I'm from America. You're gonna specifically say what borough you're from, what project you're from, what block you're from. You're not gonna say I'm from America because you're in here. The same way if you're from Africa and it's different tribes, customs, cultures, and languages, you're gonna identify with that specific one in that place, of course. But for a people who have been brought from that whole landmass here, because we don't know specifically who we are as a starting point or a reference, we say Africa. That's not chess. That's checkers. It's not that hard. I mean, people are
we know
we're not shallow enough not to know that there were specific tribes in Africa. This is not some bug out by some person in America that has no idea that there's different cultures in Africa. We're the conscious community here. We call ourselves conscious because we're aware of that fact.
So now, I just got one last example. If we got two buildings, and I live in this building, and someone says, are you from that building right there? I'm going to say, no, I'm not from that building, but I live in the second floor. So therefore I'm not gonna identify myself as being from that building. I'm gonna identify myself as being.
Yo, when somebody says you from that building, you're not going to say that.
I was providing an analogy. You about to deal with the realistics of the culture in this society.
Let me just say this.
First of all, if somebody says to you,
are you from that building, you're going to say, yeah, I'm from D7. That's what you're going to do. You're not going to say no.
So I'm going to tell them my exact apartment.
I'm saying you won't.
hold on. Don't have no questions.
The point I'm trying to make is you're going to tell them, or maybe you say, yeah, I live on such and such floor. See, now, this is the word semantics. I'm saying you're going to tell them as specific as you have knowledge of. That's all I'm saying.
So if I know I live in D7, and they ask me, am I from that building, I'm going to tell them I'm from that.
You're going to say, yeah, I'm from this building.
Yes. Exactly. So it's the same concept, same analogy. So I'm saying, once you start telling people you're not African and you got to identify with a specific nation, then you start perpetuating division. Because now Africans no longer going to want to identify themselves as African, but now I'm identifying myself as being from Mali or being from Egypt. That don't make no sense.
Don't run it.
That don't make no sense. Or if I ask him whether he's from this
block. Nobody's running away from the title. Is Nigerian an African title?
No.
Is Nigerian an African title?
It belongs to Africa.
Is it a title of a group of people who would be located in that region, in that continent?
Yes.
All right, then.
Then they are African.
So what is wrong with identifying with your specific tribal nationality? What
is nothing wrong with identifying with your specific tribe?
Why are you sitting here trying to tell me it is?
No, but I'm saying, you getting, you not.
This is crazy to me.
You not.
This is crazy to me.
What I'm saying is, hold on.
I don't get this.
What I'm saying is, I'm going to tell you the point, because it seems irrelevant, but I'm going to tell you the point. What I'm saying is, once you start getting people to identify specifics, like for instance, and you see this in black people a lot, we all African at the end of the day, right? But then you may have an African that says, oh, I'm not African, I'm Jamaican.
That's right.
Oh, I'm not African, I'm Haitian. Then you start perpetuating division. So I'm saying, once you get people to identify with specifics, it's nothing wrong with identifying with specifics as long as you know who you are. But once you limit that, oh, you know, you're not African, but you know, you're from Mali or you're from Nigeria, then you start perpetuating division. Then people start losing, which is in Africa, then people start losing the sense of their identity and no longer remain in contact with who they are.
Oh, hold. Let me give you an example. Let me give you an example.
Thank you.
Let me give you an example.
When we dealing with people.
We can't talk at the same time, man. Come on, man. Listen. At the end of the day, that's a poodle. That's a Rockweller. That's a pit bull. We all dogs, right? But we have different names. But we still a dog. So if we dealing with Africa, we may have Nigeria, we may have South Africa, we may have the Congo, we may have whatever. But everybody originated in one place. That's Africa. That's what we call it anyway. You know what I'm saying? So where's the confusion at? Why we can't all get along?
And when people trace their DNA, it always goes back to somewhere in West Africa for the most part. Somewhere in West Africa. So people are finding out with technological advancement, with study, research, we are finding out specifically where we are from. As a starting point, we know that as a frame of reference, the majority of our people here in America are of Africa. What is called Africa, we are of that descent and lineage. We have history in Africa. Before Marcus Garvey and the 1920s started to try to get the black ships to go back, the black starships rather, excuse me, to go make this journey back to the motherland in Africa. Let's go back 100 years before that. You had something called the Mayflower of Liberia that left right from New York Harbor, taking hundreds and hundreds of blacks right from here in America back to what is called Liberia now in Africa. Liberia means liberal, liberty town, you know? So you have people that have been making sojourns back to Africa, has been setting up colonies there. There's been little civil wars and things like that going on, little tribal differences because you're trying to not reintegrate, but what is the word? Repatriate back into your land of nativity. But we have history of going back there. There are successful stories of people who have went back home from here and have went there and made great strides and who are doing well over there. Some brothers who are former Panthers who went, made their return back to Africa. We always see that and always know that. Hold up, listen. Pan-Africanism is even accepted on behalf of many of the people who are continental Africans. For instance, I'll give you an example, the brother Muammar Gaddafi, who is a Berber, meaning of North African native descent, okay? Now, he overthrew King Idris after a 50-year monarchy reign to liberate his people and has ruled in Africa. And if you read his literature, his books, one specifically is the Little Green Book. You know how the communists had the Little Red Book, right, brother?
Right.
He had the Little Green Book. And there's a chapter called the Third Universal Theory. And within the Third Universal Theory, he talks about how blacks in America, how Africa is their seat, their home, their throne, and how them as a people in diaspora, it was time for them to raise up. It's going to be a cultural, social phenomenon for them to raise up. And he was wanting to contribute to the resurrection culturally, socially, so on and so forth, economically, of the blacks in diaspora, specifically here in America, and went on to support and finance the initiatives of many people trying to aspire to accomplish that goal. Jeff Fort, out in Chicago, from the one of the gang members out in Chicago, from where the El Rokans eventually descended from, he was one case in point, the Nation of Islam under Farrakhan. So you have people who like Idi Amin, people like Patrice Lumumba, Kwame Nkrumah, who always put out and extended a hand in the spirit of Pan-Africanism to reach out to the blacks here in America. So when we act like they don't accept us as Africans or we're not African, what that is just layers and layers and layers of European colonialization on our minds. We have to dig through them layers to get to the core of who and what we really are. And that is African, whether we accept it or not. So what, we got different complexions over here. We are people that have been raped, robbed, lied to. We are product, we are people that's a product of being lied to. We've been socialized and colonialized into the psychology that you see us exhibiting now, to the point where we are so confused that we're even arguing whether we are African or not. And then to elude the fact that we are, we get into petty word semantics and straw man arguments such as, what tribe are you from specifically? We don't know what tribe we are specifically because we've been robbed of that knowledge, but we know to start with, and in order for us to even desire and truly accomplish the mission of finding out who we are specifically, we have to consider the land of nativity and origin to begin to start on that trekking or journey to find out who we are, to re-identify ourselves with that. And even if we are those people, we are different now here. Regardless, we are still African descent here in America. We're going to throw our different spin on things and our different, no matter what tribe we are. We are socially and culturally different now, but we know that the reference points for our land of nativity or origin is Africa. There's no denying that. Science has proven that via DNA. Okay? So there's no denying that. Only thing you are is in denial. You can't deny the fact. You're just in denial of it. I mean, you can't disprove the fact, but you are in denial of the fact. You know, so we got to get on back. Like Malcolm X said, we are out of our African minds.
You know, the brother could, you know, I mean, I couldn't have said it no better myself. But at the end of the day, we have to try to find a way on how to get along with all these different levels of knowledge.
That's right.
Because we have all these different people around the country who give lectures on all kind of different topics, but they can't sit down and discuss on how to get the hell out of the mess that we're in. All this information, man, you know what I'm saying? And babies are still dying in the street. That crack is still shooting us in the back. You know what I'm saying? You know, people, kids are still being molested in the houses. You understand? What's going on with that? You know what I'm saying? We are sick people. You know what I'm saying? We have to understand that in order for us to recognize how to go from left to right, we have to understand that we are sick and we need help.
Go ahead.
You know what I'm saying? And the only way we can get help is that we have to look within inside ourselves and understand that we've been transformed, you know what I'm saying, to somebody else, to what we were when we were brought over here from Africa. We have became a new creation. You know what I'm saying? Well, we can't be activated to do anything beneficial for ourselves because we don't love ourselves. Self-hatred is one of the key components to our lives. Brother, do you have something to say about what I just said? What do you think about the youth in the inner circles, man? Why do you think they're killing each other inside the hood?
Why I think they're killing each other inside the hood? Well, one reason is because we all feel that we divided. That's one reason. The second reason is because of gangs. It's not even because of gangs. It's because of gangs going against each other. Now, when gangs was first originated, we could take this back to Crip and Bloods. They were for the community.
Right.
Now, some way, somehow, they was turned against that. Now we fight each other. You feel me? So, basically now, what gangs are, they doing the white man's job so that he doesn't have to do it. You feel me?
Mm.
The white man doesn't necessarily have to come in our community and kill us because we already doing that. You understand? We already doing that. So I'm going to let my son finish off though. Feel me? But that was the start of it though.
Well, the question was asked, why are the youth in our community killing one another? Exactly. You know what I'm saying? And when will it stop?
Well, yeah, that is. A lot of them, again, it goes back to culture. A lot of them don't feel culturally connected to each other. They don't feel connected to each other in any way, shape, or form. They see the present reality and they don't identify. A lot of them don't even know their history. They don't identify themselves as African, therefore they don't feel relative to each other. So if I don't feel like I have any connection to you, blood connection, or if I don't feel like we share some kind of collective condition, I won't necessarily fend for you. I'll probably kill you off faster than I would someone in my, like, for instance, if I'm from a specific project and you from a specific project, but we both from Brownsville, if I hear you from that project and you messing with somebody from my projects, I'm a, but just in general, if you come and mess with somebody from my projects, I'm going to deal with you accordingly because you messing with somebody from my specific, it's like a neighbor, it's basically just taking a macroscopic picture and just showing a microscopic reflection. So even if you deal with a country, if I'm from America and then I go to some, and then I go to Europe and then someone in Europe comes and I defend an American before I defend a European because we share collective, condition, we share collective reality. So I say this to say that the youth, from what I see, are very violent because they don't feel connected to each other. They don't feel like they share anything close to each other in any way, shape, or form. So I don't necessarily have any remorse or any hesitation in killing another brother because I don't feel like he's another brother.
Does the rap artists have anything to do with the language that the youth use or disrespect the black woman in the community? Does it have anything to do with the youth? I mean, with the rappers and their lyrics and the things they say?
So, state that one more time.
The rappers who use the negative words, bitches, hoes, and have real disrespectful language that they're using in their raps, do you think that that has an effect on all youth, or do some youth disregard that, or do they use that language because they're hearing the rappers call females bitches and hoes?
The experiences you decide to internalize are the ones that become a part of you. The influences you decide to internalize are the ones that become a part of you. So if you're a household, we're social creatures, so at the end of the day, if I see someone have a certain characteristic, especially if they're close to me, I'm gonna adopt that characteristic one way or another. Not by nature, but by nurture. So therefore, if I'm in a household and everyone's calling women bitches, and I hear rap music calling women bitches, that's the norm. So I'm gonna call women bitches. That's just how it goes. So I feel like it's really the nurture and what people see and how they choose to identify with it. So if my household does it, to grow up in a specific environment and not internalize anything from that environment, that means that you deviated from your nurture. You naturally went straight from the natural process of your nurture. So if I'm from a place of poverty where violence is normally committed, yet I'm in no way, shape, or form violent, and I'm very timid, that means I've deviated from the nurture of my society because my society perpetuates violence and perpetuates aggression. So I'm saying, when you say, does the rap music influence youth and does the rap music make youth call women this, that, and the third? Of course the rap music does, but you gotta understand, you can't blame black people for everything that black people go through. Like, for instance, to say that, oh, you know, why can't white people call black people nigga? And I'm just providing an example. Like, why can't white people call black people nigga, but black people call black people nigga? Or why do black people even use the word nigga in their rap videos if it's supposed to be wrong? I can use the word nigga in my rap videos, but why do I use it in the context that I do use it? Who psychologically castrated me, or who weakened me enough to make me think that the word nigga was good? Who created my condition? Who created my condition of poverty? Who made me want to call somebody a bitch? Who made me want to rob? So at the end of the day, our reality is created as a consequence of white imperialism. People want to blame black people for everything. And don't get me wrong, you could blame a black man for certain things, but your reality is the consequence of white imperialism. Black people wouldn't be walking around shooting other black people for money if they weren't enslaved for 400 years. The foundation of this country's wealth is based, on African labor. That's all it is. So at the end of the day, our reality is the consequence of white imperialism. Our poverty is the consequence of white imperialism. Every black man that kills another black man is the consequence of white imperialism. So if you blame a black man for killing another black man and you say it's their fault, what put them in that condition? So now we talking about the specific black people in America. So if we're dealing with America, the condition of America and what created the black American reality is white imperialism. So, I just feel like if you're dealing with a black man in America, you gotta understand that the present is only a consequence of the past.
Yeah, that's right.
So the reason our situation is the way it is because of certain events that happened, which we already know. So long story short, the need for us to do certain things stems from a reality that created the need. So you can't necessarily say that every black man, that every black man in America is the cause of their problem or they perpetuate their problem. They grew up in the environment of that problem. That's the only reality they know, the problem. So therefore, if they perpetuate it, they're perpetuating their lifestyle because that's what they live. So you can't necessarily blame a black man for being hood if that's the condition he was put into.
Thank you so much, my brother, man. I mean, you know, I appreciate your insight. And I appreciate you for being a good student, brother, you know what I'm saying, and studying well, man, and get that information and give it back to the people. I also want to say that my brother right here, man, is going to give us another insight on what he feels rap music and all the negative connotations in the music have done or haven't done to actually uplift the youth in our community.
Well, good question. Thank you for a question. Such good critical question that allows me to tap into my mental resource to expound on and give you an answer that requires a great analysis due to the kind of great critical question that was asked of me, okay? So I wanted to say that as far as what rap music has or hasn't done, let's deal with what the has done. Let's, matter of fact, let's go back because we're talking about, I'm assuming.
Before I burn out,
Let me answer the question because you cutting in at the wrong time. I don't know why you want to do a commercial on PSA. You want to do a PSA on my time? Nah. You gotta wait, brother. You gotta wait. So like I was saying, you gotta wait on that, brother. You gotta wait on that one, bro. You can wait to the end. If it's 60 seconds, you can wait to the end. Now, like I was saying, as far as hold on, man. Go ahead.
All right, wait. Real quick, family, you know, I'm enjoying the build that everybody doing here, but we need action, you know what I mean? So I do want to say I got a couple interviews coming out with Sa.Netr and with Underground Railroad where I'm speaking on some things that I'm putting into action where everybody can come together and make money. It's not a thing where I'm trying to make money for myself. It's a thing where I want to help everybody make money. You get what I'm saying? So just be on the lookout for that. I want to say that, and that's what we just need. Let's stop talking. Let's be more about some action. I want to say black power, and I appreciate the 60 seconds the brothers gave me, and y'all just keep building out here, man. All right. And yes, black peace, power. Black power.
You kind of went over your 60-second. You went over your 60-second PSA, but we're going to let you slide because we needed to hear that. We needed to hear that, and that was real talk, black power. All right, traveling harmony, brother. Yeah, and he's right, because what we need to start doing is, along with being pro-analytical and pro-research, which is very important, I was listening to, and I'm going to go back to answering the original question, what the state of hip-hop, what has it contributed, good or bad, to the black community. But I was listening to a powerful video by our brother, Dr. Amos Wilson, the other night, the falsification of African consciousness, or the falsification of black consciousness. And he goes into analyzing and studying the dichotomy of talk, pro-talk versus pro-action. And a lot of us, what we need to do is we need to realize we don't never need to stop talking. Because once you stop talking, you stop evaluating, you stop evolving, and you stop putting all your creativity into that which is necessary in an ever-evolving and ever-advancing world. So you never stop talking. You never stop building. Because right now, as you see technological advancements happening all around you, guess what? There's meetings or talking going on that's taking place because a thought is a blueprint of what's to take place in the physical. The physical is a manifestation of an original thought. Thought has to be talked to be communicated to people so they come together in a general consensus type of way to figure out how they ought to do what it is that they blueprinted that they were going to do and to make it manifest into action. So we have to talk.
That's mental technology.
That's right. That's mental technology.
Technology precedes physical technology because it's built in the mind first, then it's built in the real world. It comes down a tree. So mental technology is solving problems, concepts, ideas, doctrines, thoughts, high thoughts. So what you see take place is technology in its finest form. in its finest form. And what this is going to produce in the physical is innumerable.
It's all relevant. It's all relevant. It's all going to tie in. Watch how I tie it all into it, though. It's like you see this building right here. There was original thought or idea that somebody had, conversations that went down, some disagreements, some agreements. But when you've seen the finished product, this is a result of an original thought. So I'm saying that to say this. We don't never need to stop talking about our plight, our issues. We never need to stop exposing contradictions. We never need to stop fighting for the hearts and minds of our people. But we do have to match it and upgrade our involvement and being proactive to bring about practical solutions that we see having a powerful, positive, and a healing impact on us in a collective level. That's what we need to start doing, but it first starts with the thought, it starts with the communication that we're having, and as you see this consciousness and this knowledge and this platform, as many others, expanding and people becoming aware of what the problem is, people are joining on to bringing whatever knowledge or resource or gift or skill capability they have to the table to pool those resources into being a powerful, positive proponent to bring about some kind of tangible change that we definitely do need. So it's not like nobody is out here not working. It's not like there's nobody out here teaching about the real estate classes, because we need to have equity. We need to have land. We need to have an economic base. It's not like nobody's out here actually healing. We have the people that's doing the healing, like Queen Afua, okay? It's not like there's not brothers and sisters out here doing things to reach out. It's not like we don't have the military base, the new Black Panther Party, many other Pan-Africanist radical nationalist groups that are standing up. So we have all the things that are needed to make a nation. Only thing that we don't have and we're still building and unifying and putting together is unified principle. Principled unity, sorry.
Unified thought.
Unified, collective unified thought, which is the blueprint to principled unity. Okay? So now when I want to go back to the original question, now this ties into hip-hop. Because hip-hop has a lot to do with, you said, what it doesn't do for us and what it did do. It did good and bad. It has done a lot and it has taken away a lot. So let's put these things in perspective accordingly. Now, when we talk about what hip hop, I'm going to deal with the paradigm of hip hop from maybe, let's say, 1987, 88 up to now. Because hip hop in its inception, hip hop is a term, is hip. Like, you know, the term hip is something that's cool, savvy, you know what I'm saying? It's something that's it's a slang and a swag that we used in the hood. Hip-hop, you know? So you got to understand the music that it came out of was born out of different types of music that we've had. And this sojourn, the social reality that we were dealing with at the specific time, our music would always reflect that. Jazz, the blues reflected a condition that we were in. Jazz reflected conditions at a said time that we were in. Gospel music, which was the Africanization, adding the beats, the drums, and a type of rhythm that we had to Christian hymns, was a result of the said time that we were dealing in. Hip hop, coming from a time where, let's look at the time. There was a time where after a lot of so-called social programs went into effect to put money into the school systems to make the performing arts and things like that available to the Black youth, the Black and Latino youths in the school systems. A lot of that was going on in the 60s, late 60s, mid 60s and 70s. During the time of Reaganomics, a lot of those programs through Reaganomics were canceled. So a lot of the same instruments or performing art classes and things like that no longer existed in the school. So you see brothers wasn't beating on the drums no more. They started to beat on the lockers, the tables and things like that. You know what I mean? Because we're improvisers, because we have that creative spirit in us by nature. So, like, hip-hop was born out of the social conditions and the social reality that reflected through our music. We vented it through our music. If you notice, all songs, all genre of music, all have rhymes in them. All the songs rhyme. They don't rhyme the same way as hip-hop. See, hip-hop rhymes, you know, but unlike other music where it has the ability to make people dance, hip-hop or rap music has the ability to make them the words themselves dance. You know, and that's why people would just sit there and just bop their head. They even gotta, cause the lyrics themselves are making the words dance. opposed to other forms of music which still have rhymes in it, making people just dance. So hip hop has given a lot. Hip hop was born in a time where it was fun up in the South Bronx, block party, battle rapping, DJs, you know, in its inception, hip hop was fun. So you had the dancing, the break dancing, the graffiti, all of these different components which went into it, what the hip hop culture was. There's in war-torn neighborhoods. Okay, heroin, prostitution, poverty, disproportionate distribution of wealth and privilege was the paradigm of the reality that we were living in, that our music therefore reflected in the form of rap music, when rap is just one of the formulas of hip-hop, because hip-hop has different components or elements to it. The music, the style that we dress, the graffiti, the breakdancing, rap was just one of those components to what we call hip-hop. So hip-hop, there's five pillars of hip-hop. You can get that in a book by our very intelligent brother, Black Dot, who has hip-hop decoded. Powerful book that goes in layers, because I can't possibly drop it on you everything like he does in that book within a little limited time that I have to drop the science that I'm going to give to you. So check that book out, definitely, okay? But you had, when they started to say hip-hop at first, was a type of genre of music that was a fad. Record execs wasn't signing that. They wasn't getting major spins on the radio stations. We wasn't getting major spins like that. Hardly no spins. That's what they said hip hop would be.
Is that the same as the gay thing that's going on now? Is that a fad?
Well, we don't want to be all over the place. That's not even a fad. They're trying to make that an institution. It's starting off as a fad, but they have that's an agenda. You know? Now, this is something that outside forces are trying to put into our culture, our alien customs and way of life that they're trying to inoculate us with. Okay? However, this was something that we brought for our own genre of music and art form and music that they said was a fad. They didn't take that much of an interest in it. They didn't see it long in his last and having such a global impact as it has right now on the world. I remember one time you said, and just drop it real quick, when you said they did a study, and what university was that in England that said hip hop was the most influential culture in the world?
I believe it was the London University and the Queen's College, I believe. Yeah. One of the highest prestigious colleges is higher than America in the world.
Yeah, that means bigger than MIT, Harvard, Yale, Brown University. And this is a recent study down in the University of England, which determined that hip-hop, because of its influence, it has an influence over the world. Japan, hip-hop is big. England, hip-hop is big. South Africa, hip-hop is big. This was a genre of music that started
of all genres that
ever existed. But this is a genre
that's
the most powerful. But hear what I'm saying. But out of all genres, okay, of music that ever existed, this is the most influential one culturally, globally speaking, on an ecumenical or global level.
So it hits everybody.
So it's impacting everybody. Everybody's imitating, trying to rap. You got rappers in London. You got rappers in South Africa and Japan. They cutting the turntables, rapping in Japanese. Yeah, that's a beautiful thing, because that goes to show you the creative power of the black mind, what we had to do. See, hip-hop started off as a positive, powerful thing. They thought it wouldn't. They thought it wasn't going to have a long-term impact. They didn't think it was going to have a long-term impact the way that it did, this genre of music. But look at it now. And once they started to see the power that hip-hop had, that's when the small hats got involved with it.
Small hats, who's that?
The so-called Jew. The so-called Jew got involved with it then, because they seen the power of hip-hop. And any type of genre of music that we've ever done, or sports, or anything that we've ever been involved with, and they seen that it would be successful, the small hat has usually been there right behind us. Mm. The secret relationship between the blacks and Jews, the speech by Farrakhan, he goes into a lot of specific details of dates, times, places, names, and specifics, okay? You can just check that out. Do your research. You got your homework. And it's not that hard. All you got to do is just look around, open a few books. You'll see that. And it'll jump right out at you. It's just history. Now, once they started to see that hip-hop had the type of captivating power and impact globally that it was growing into, to have that kind of global impact, they wanted to kind of control that dynamic of where it was going. They wanted to invest in it then. You know? They anything we do, they invest in it, and they usually try to take it over and try to change the direction of where it goes. Hip-hop was no different. The thing with hip-hop was, is because that is the most influential genre, cultural genre, not just music, cultural genre ever, you got to understand the ominous effects that it had, is having, and will have long term because of the direction that has been turned to go to by design through agenda, because they said, wow, if this can have an impact globally, and this is created by these people, we got to make sure we control the message. Because if the message is too powerful as far as conscious, because hip-hop started off in its inception as fun, something to dance to, and it also had a point to ponder. It also talked about social realities with a social relevant message in it. Most hip-hop, you know? Now, as the hip-hop started to grow and expand, you started to see people investing in small hats, when I say people specifically, investing, and not everyone that they invested in just turned it to the left and it just went to garbage, because we had Run DMC, you know what I'm saying? It started, they used them too, they kind of crossed over with them.
That's fine, that's what we're doing.
Okay. Yeah, check that out, brother. Get that, eat that knowledge. Now, so I was saying, is like for NWA, for instance, when that, I think that that was a pilot program to see how far degenerate that we can become, be made to become through that specific genre of music, hip hop. Okay, and the reason why I said it, because I'm not that old, but I'm not young. Here it is, I'm 41 years old, so I remember when NWA first came out. I remember before that, we was like, Milk is chilling, Giz is chilling, what more can I say, Top Ellen? 87, you know what I mean? You know what time it is, Grandmaster Flash, you know what I'm saying? We was vibing to hip-hop. Hip-hop was fun, and those days was wild. It was crack era, epidemic had just hit then, gangs was rampant in the city that I'm from, in New York, other places, you know? Gangs was rampant, the crime rate was rampant, war-torn neighborhoods, prostitution rampant, AIDS was just hit the streets, but the music still had a positive message or a socially relevant message in it that people would still be able to bop their heads to, dance to, and have fun with. Now, I noticed with NWA, and I used to like NWA, I ain't on front. I still do. I like the damn music. I don't like it the way I did when I was lost. I mean, I liked the hard beats, the audacity that they had. You know what I mean? Like, it was hard. And back in that time, I remember when they first hit the streets and that change of hip-hop, they wasn't getting no spins on the radio. So when we heard of NWA, we heard of it just by word of the mouth on the streets. Yo, check this CD, this tape cassette out. You know what I mean? Because there wasn't no CDs back then. So I remember when I first heard that, this is like, I think this was before the F the Police, the Fuck the Police one, which was, when they first came out. No, when they first came out, it was Eazy-E. It was just Eazy-E. It was Eazy Does It was the album, and it was just him. Like, even though they said he wasn't the writer of the crew, he really wasn't even a rapper. They had to show him how to rap and really get him in a studio and prep him to become the rapper that he eventually became, you know? But his album came out first, Eazy Does It, and it was hardcore. And that was new then, because we wasn't hearing people swearing and cussing and talking about social realities in the way that we heard Eazy-E first expounding on it through his lyricism. And it was just crazy. It was off the chain. You know what I mean? So a lot of people coming from the neighborhoods I came from, crack epidemic was there. The streets was wild, AIDS, prostitution, gangs was rampant. I come from in Boston, you know, Roxbury, Dorchester, Massachusetts. Same thing that was going on out here. We was intrigued by that. And we kind of started begin to relish that kind of music, because it was like, it was hard. They got the audacity to talk about, you don't even hear this on the radio. A lot of people in our community, because of the cracks was there, the epidemic was there, of other just social realities, the music, it seemed like, became the soundtrack to the whole new wave of gang culture and violence that was inspired heavily through that genre of music. Because like I said, prior to that, the same social conditions existed, but the music wasn't there glorifying it and talking to them, yes, glorifying it, because NWA did glorify that lifestyle. You hear the songs like Gangsta, Gangsta, Eazy-E's fucked up and got the eight ball rolling. She swallowed it. When you hear the song, She Swallowed It. Yeah, remember that? You know, that's before your time. She swallowed it, yeah. They're talking about knocking out chicks and putting his penis in her mouth and moving it all around. He says all this literally in the lyrics. He talks about a 13-year-old girl that's a preacher's daughter. They're running a train on her in the car. MC Ren jumps in and he smashes it and all kind of different stuff. This was what they was talking about and glorifying in the music. The small hat was, yeah, and they was going platinum with no radio spins. I mean, they came out with Express Yourself. I'm expressing with my full capability. They had a couple of hits, but this is after they already became known and without having spins for the type of negative John Way rap. And they made a lot of contributions, not just them, Because a lot of people, we talk about NWA, but we forget about that out of NWA was inspired other very negative gangster rap groups. It was NWA, then it was something called BWA that came up, right, with bitches with attitudes. And then it was HWP, hoes with problems, that came out after that. And it had, it was just crazy. And then you had, it just went crazy. And then we noticed a shift between East Coast, which cornered the market on hip hop, as far as the much as spins it was getting, as far as the influence that it was having on a global level, and a socially relevant, for the most part, socially relevant type of conscious lyrics that they were kicking, to the West Coast, which dealt with a very hardcore reality over there. And when you look at the dichotomy between the East and the West, yeah, we had the drugs, we had the heroin epidemics, we had the war-torn neighborhoods, the slums and all that. Philadelphia, Boston, Jersey, New York City, of course. Where crack cocaine was first used as a social destruction pilot program right there by the CIA in California, right in Los Angeles.
That's why he's a spokesman for the House of Consciousness. You see how he goes in? We touch on many topics. This is my brother Sankofa, the spokesman for Sa.Netr T.V., Black News 102, House of Consciousness. All right, brother. Sorry I had to do that.
Thank you, brother. Another PSA, man, from yours truly, brother Sa.Netr. All right? So like I was saying, we got to look at, and the reason why I'm going into a lot of history, some people might say, just answer the question. I am answering the question. But see, our people are so used to fast food, and you are what you eat, that we desire fast answers. We want the answers to our critical situations and problems to be oversimplified with a few words, because we don't think that much of ourselves. We don't think that what happened to us, how it happened to us, and how it is so impacting on us, where it has such a hypnotic effect on us socially, psychologically speaking, spiritually even speaking. We think that there wasn't a very complex layers, critical layers of complexities into how this was done. So in explaining these things, I'm not going to dissect every single nook and cranny of it, but I have to give you a historical layout, and I have to connect the dots, and it makes the answer that I give you have more value, because it has more of a historical backdrop to it, and it gives you a more tapestry of understanding when you can understand not only did NWA F up a lot of the conditions socially, was a contribution, but not even really them, the machine behind them really used them as puppets and used that as a social pilot program for destruction, for social destruction and degeneracy. Use people like NWA just to see the impact, just like when they use crack cocaine in the form of crack, because MK Ultra invented crack cocaine before it hit the streets way back in the 1950s. Look that up. And they were using it on wards of the states, such as people in the mental institutions, people in the military, okay, people in some even just American regular civilians. And you can look at a YouTube video where it's called Bill Clinton Apologizes for MK Ultra Using Psychotropic Drugs and Other Controlled Chemical Substances on the American Public Without Them Knowing. They apologized them, and crack cocaine was one of them. Crack cocaine didn't just pop up in the 80s on every street in America. It hit California first and then just spread everywhere out of nowhere.
You said Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton's husband, it was a part of that?
No, I didn't say he was a part of it. He made an apology, a public apology for the system that he was a part of. He wasn't a part of, but he was a puppet of a system and connected and a part of the system that was a part of the epidemic that spawned the gang culture, the epidemics that you've seen ravish our already war-torn communities from the 80s on up to now. Okay, these crack babies all grown up. No disrespect to them, because a lot of people were ravished and a lot of women, so I'm not disrespecting anybody who was unfortunately born in that kind of situation. But I'm saying a lot of them who were grown up had grown up chemically imbalanced and more subjected to be criminal, especially without the lack of father, because a lot of black men went to prisons and wasn't around like that because of the crack epidemic, or lost their lives. So in a community that was already ravished, war-torn, a lot of children being born out of wedlock and broken homes, it was took up to a whole nother level, because now you had AIDS and you had crack. So you had a lot of the mothers and the fathers wasn't in the house now, because a lot of the mothers was out prostituting or were dying from AIDS and all these epidemics. And then you had the children who were born out of that generation with the gangsterization of rap music, the genre of rap music, okay, as being a soundtrack to those conditions that we were subject to and affected by socially. You have what you see now in this generation and the generation after that, a byproduct, a subproduct, and a direct product of those social engineering campaigns.
Wait. I'm not trying to skip the topic, but we have Hillary Clinton who's running for president. All right, now, do you know about the things that our husband brought into existence for his laws that he passed for black people?
We're going to go into that. No, I'm going to tie it into hip-hop because it goes into that era.
Because
NWA.
My time is limited, brother. That's why I'm asking you that. You know what I'm saying? You know, I want the people to know, before you vote for this lady, find out what our husband did, because the brother is going to explain exactly what three things that he passed, and you're getting ready to vote for his wife.
Okay, brother. Who's getting ready to vote for his wife?
Whoever.
I thought you was talking about somebody specific. The way you said it, he said you're getting ready to vote for his wife.
Whoever.
First things first, last things last. Let me just finish expounding on what I'm going to tie that point into it. And it's really relevant because Bill Clinton was elected into office in January 1992. He had two presidential runs. And you got to understand, like, certain laws that he passed made it so there was, like, zero tolerance laws to make sure that a lot of black men wouldn't get out of prison. So to make sure that with the difference between you selling crack cocaine or powder cocaine was totally different, even though they come from the same origin, cocaine, cocoa leaf, that the black community was more subject to get waived three times more time than you were if you were white caught with powder cocaine. Yes, Vlad.
The system is getting a certain way for black people to get subjugated. So, for instance, 5 grams of crack is worth the equivalent of 500 grams of cocaine. Statistically, black people do crack more and white people do coke more. Yet 5 grams of crack is the equivalent of 500 grams of cocaine. The system is geared in a way for black people to be prosecuted for minor crimes so that they can be convicted of a felony and then legally discriminated against. But, you know,
that ties into the Bill Clinton administration. A lot of other things do too, and this happened around the time with. And hold up, and I talked about this too during the time of the Clinton administration, and I spoke on it briefly on one of my last interviews on Sa.Netr T.V., Sa.Netr Studios, where there was something called the infamous, have you ever heard about it, young brother?
What?
The infamous record label meeting. There was a meeting between record label execs and people who were big time prison investors. And what they wanted to do was, they kind of told them to use them as intermediaries to make hip hop be promoted as more of a negative John Ray type of music in the culture, because they said with you doing that and you hiring more of these young disenfranchised men to talk about materialism, murder, rape, and degradation in their communities, it will have a corresponding impact on, because it has people, whether you agree with it or not, nobody makes them do that. Psychology is ill. With a beat and with lyrics, and when you perpetually hear that, it has almost a hypnotic effect to it. Hold on. Let me finish.
Your mind operates on frequencies.
Operates off frequencies. So once you're constantly hearing these things and you're already in a socially ravished community that crack epidemics, poverty, and violence is consuming these communities, then you have a music like a soundtrack behind that. You got to look at the corresponding impact that it has on the minds of the children. They were told in this meeting, young brothers, they was told to hire young disenfranchised blacks and Latinos to perpetuate specifically the criminal content in hip-hop, because therefore it will inspire others to try to live this lifestyle in hope of a dream of being that $1 million nigga in the corner that made it out, you know what I'm saying, the ghetto by hustling, selling drugs, or you got some kind of status or respect in the community because you're a G and you're a killer, you're a goon. So this kind of thing was perpetuated, and it was, and you can look this up, because some people might sound like, that's a conspiracy theory. No, through the Freedom of Information Act, a lot of things are out, and it's public information, so you got to utilize this information to educate your mind so you can understand what's going on and exactly what you're fighting against. In order to have a successful victory, you got to know exactly how things were stacked up against you and the stratagems that they used in different layers to do it, because we can't oversimplify complex issues. This shit gets deep. Now, they said that they utilized the record execs to hire young blacks and Latinos. Rap music didn't just go from conscious to extremely negative out of nowhere, because that's something that we wanted. Like, we went and said, nah, record label execs. No, we want real niggas rocking these mics now and talking about degradation and knocking out women and raping them and killing up niggas and shooting 45, 60 different niggas and wearing red and blue bandanas. That's not what we did. This is something that the white hats and other people who had invested interest in our destruction were behind. It was an agenda, and it's called the Record Label Exec Secret Meeting. Look this up when you get a chance. Yeah, look that up when you get a chance. And it'll tie into Bill Clinton came up right off of that with these laws that he put in because they knew that what this will do in a and the prison population soared from, I believe, in 1983 it was like 200,000 people incarcerated to over 2 million. America, United States of America, has the highest prison population
in the world.
Yeah. And it's only 5% of the 5% of the people on the planet only live in America. So in America, if you're American, you're 5% by default, population-wise, not doctrine-wise. You know, but it has the highest. You know why? Because this is a corporate plutocracy called America. So therefore, when you're dealing with corporatocracy, crime pays, and it benefits. Yes, and crime pays because it benefits for the people in higher echelon who has no value and sees no value and doesn't even desire you here. You were brought here to work anyway. Now they feel like your time is up. We're just extra mouths to feed. So in a depopulation campaign through abortion, hip-hop music was part of that campaign. It wasn't just one thing. They got the cards stacked up against us in many ways and many shape, forms, and fashion. But see, our eyes are so wide shut, not wide open, wide shut, that we don't even see how the enemy's coming at us in 3D, HD, and surround sound. It's all around you. So what we got to do is invent a frequency. Matter of fact, add on to what you just wanted to build on, too. I like to let the youth teach, too, because, you know, us older heads, we've been in front of this camera for years, dropping knowledge. It's a beautiful thing to see these. Look at these young brothers right here. Here, and this brother right here, as the way he's able to articulate himself and the way he's able to give dates, times, and break down his point and connect the dots so eloquently is he is beautiful. You know, it lets us know that there is hope in our future. We're planting the right seeds, and this is the fruit and the product of that, and he's going to create even better ones, making the bloodline stronger, man. This young brother right here, all you brothers, I want to commend y'all and thank y'all, because you know what, we can sit here and kick it for years. It's about the new generation. It's about y'all. It's about y'all waking it up, taking it to a whole nother level. Add on,
this is what happened when you teach youth.
That's right. Bam.
What he was saying about corporate America and how this country's a corporate system, the agenda of America has always been to put black people in a position of subjugation so that they can work and make America's money for them. So if you look at American history from its inception, American history has always built its wealth upon the use of free labor. Beginning with indentured servants, once indentured servitude became extinguished, then it became slavery. From slavery, you had convict leases. Now, after convict leasing, you had mass incarceration, where they would prosecute people for minor crimes like crack. They would do an exaggerated amount of time. And from that exaggerated amount of time, be subject to legal discrimination. It's not really about how much time you label the felon. It's about you legally can't vote. You legally can't get housing. You legally can't get hired at certain jobs. So it legally allows them to discriminate against you. So the system, it's a book called A New Jim Crow, where the lady, Alexander Michelle, she describes it as preservation through transformation, where you preserve the goal, but you change the superficial layer of how it goes, of how you go about maintaining that goal. So before, when we were slaves and slavery finally got extinguished, the way they tried to preserve slavery was with the 13th Amendment. They abolished slavery with the exception of it being used as consequence for a crime. Then you had convict leasing, and with convict leasing, we were leased for minor crimes such as being homeless and jobless. They put us in a position of subjugation so that they could recover the economy of the South. Then going even further, now today, mass incarceration, black people only take up 14.1% of the population. White people take up 77.7% of the population. If you exclude Hispanic whites, then you got 62% of the population. How is it that 80% of the people under the criminal justice system are black. That's because the criminal justice system is geared in a way where it's specifically addressing black people. And the thing about it is that sometimes, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying applaud what the white man does, but applaud the beauty of the strategy. Like, you gotta understand, most of these white people don't think of themselves as racist. They don't. But on a subconscious level, you got shows like Empire, frick, you got shows like Empire, Scandal, all these things promoting an image of a black reality that, isn't necessarily true. And so when people go to deal with a black man, they think every black man that's rich came from a hood and sold crack and did this, that, and the third. So now when cops are out here killing black men, they're not necessarily racist. But because of their preconceptions, because of the subconscious training and programming of those police, the way they deal with us won't necessarily be the same as the way they deal with a white man. So it's really all a subconscious thing, and they're all being manipulated. The only reason this war started was to preserve the wealth of the 1%. People were trying to preserve their wealth, and because they tried to preserve their wealth, they created things like race. Once they created race, they promoted propaganda, associated the propaganda with a race, and then ended up justifying the ascension and descension of certain races. So, for instance, black people were considered three-fifths of man, so because they weren't actually whole human, when the Constitution says that every man is equal, if black people aren't whole humans, then they're not considered man. So, therefore, their enslavement is justified. So, once you start creating race, you create division, then you promote propaganda about a specific people. The minute you do that, that's the blueprint to justify their ascension or their dissension. So in this country and in this society, the means for America to earn its wealth was to subjugate people, and still is to subjugate people. Black people, unfortunately, are the ones under the pen. It could have been a Mexican, it could have been someone else, but it was black. So now the real question is, what do we do to fix this?
Powerful point, once again. And that's the case in point of what this knowledge is geared towards doing. Raising young, powerful, bright minds like him right there. And you know how long way this is to go? What we're doing is undermining and offsetting the agenda initiatives on behalf of the 1% who has an agenda to destroy and eliminate and really eradicate us from history books. When you have brothers like him, that is countering that strategy. That is undermining that strategy. That shows that there is light at the end of the tunnel and that there is hope. You know what I mean? Not that we're in a completely hopeless situations, but some see that. They don't see enough positive images. They don't hear enough young, powerful, intelligent black men, such as the brother right here you just heard so eloquently handle himself before you people out there. You know what I mean? And you know what? There's many others out there. There's many of these brothers, and we got to duplicate even more. Because this is the war we're at. We're in a war for the hearts and minds of the people. Uh-oh, there he goes. They were in a war for the hearts and minds of a people. And with soldiers like this, intellectual soldiers like this, we have weapons prepared to counter as counter stratagems for that war declared against us. You know what I mean? Hold on. That's his son?
I know.
That's his son?
Yeah, don't put him.
Say what's up to the people.